Okay, wonderful. So today is Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound is our hymn. And I need to remember to use that device. Okay, so we'll start the same way we started last week with a little bit of how to read a hymnal. And as I mentioned last week, that hymns have two titles. There's both the text and the tune each have a title. So the text is titled Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Can you guys see my mouse right now?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, can you? Excellent. Can you see? Let me see if I do this. Can you see that little red dot?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, wonderful.
I want new glasses. No, I'm teasing.
So the text is Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound, and the tune, so all the notes that are there, if you look at the bottom, let me see if I can get this down here, music, New Britain, that's the name of the tune. And so when we just call hymns by their text name, usually when we say Amazing Grace, but technically there is two titles. And so there's usually also two authors. The text for Amazing Grace was written by John Newton, and he was born in 1725, died in 1807. The tune was written by W. Walker. I believe his first name is William, but I couldn't quite find that. And his dates, for some reason, if I can zoom in down here, are not, oh, they are there. No, that's Edwin's dates. Walker, yeah, for some reason, his dates are not there. It just says 1835, which 1835 is the year that he wrote the melody. And so you'll notice that the melody for Amazing Grace was written 28 years after John Newton died. So John Newton never heard the hymn as we know it today.
Yeah. Wow.
And when it was first put out, it was most likely, at that time when texts were put out for hymns, they were most likely just chanted, kind of what we would think of as Gregorian chant, just the priest would pick a note and just chant, sing it. Almost like sometimes you hear in the Greek Orthodox Church a minister chanting the gospel, where they just pick a note and sing it. And so that's how it was originally put out. And then in 1835, Walker wrote the tune for it. And then also at the bottom down here, you can see ARR period. That stands for arranged. Edwin Excel, and those are his dates, 1851 to 1921. And that means the arrangement. So W. Walker wrote the melody. So the soprano line that we all know to sing, that was written by W. Walker. The arrangement, so then the four-part harmony part, what you see on the page here, and I keep pointing at my screen as if you guys can see my finger pointing at the screen. The arrangement is what Excel did. And so that's a little bit of all the information you can get just from looking at the page on the hymnal.
So Jeremy, since he wrote the text so much sooner than the other, would it have been written like as a poem or?
The Newton, the person who wrote this, after he wrote Amazing Grace, was known for writing hymn poetry. And so it was put together in a collection of hymns. I think I have the correct date later on in here somewhere, but somewhere, I think right around 1800, there was a collection of Newton's poetry that was put together as a hymnal. And some of them had tunes, but most of them were just chanted on a single note. So he would write it. He knew the meter. This is written in common meter, so it's Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. There's 8 syllables in the first line that saved a wretch like me, 6. 8 in the third line, 6 in the last line. So he knew the meter that he was writing in, and then the composer, when they go to write it, would do that. And the other thing too, once hymn tunes became a little bit more popular in the service, before the actual Amazing Grace was written, the text of this was actually sung to, like, I found like 8 or 9 different tunes back in the early 1800s. That it was sung to. And so Newton is English, Walker is American, and we'll talk a little bit about that later. But so the text, and I have an arrangement here. Before we dive too far into it, I want to read the text, and then I'll play my arrangement here. And you can see on the picture here that's going to be a video, a little bit of our setup in the back. So this is what you can't see when you were doing Facebook Live, all these cameras, and there's a TV monitor here for people to watch. There's a TV monitor there sideways for Bob to watch. Yeah, and so it's all sorts of going on there right now. And this over here in the corner is probably the saddest thing right now. All of the hymnals in the sanctuary have been boxed and are in moving boxes in the corner of the sanctuary. So because it's just not safe, we can't sanitize a hymnal very well. So that's all sad to see. But so the text for Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun. One thing that's interesting before I play the arrangement here for you, the fifth stanza was not written by John Newton. I think it says on here, yes, stanza five. Was anonymous. Can you guys see that I just changed slides back to the music?
No.
Not
on my computer either. That's interesting. I wonder if I just froze. Hang on, I'm going to stop the share for a second and start it again. Share screen. We want that one. And then we want to go here. Oops, I need to
Hi, Ben.
Hi.
More people.
Okay, let's see if we went live again. Yep, okay. For some reason, just froze up. So stanza five, down here, you can see on the text, stanzas one through four were written by John Newton. Stanza five is anonymous. And in the LBW, the green hymnal that we had back, that came out in 82, I believe, or 78, one of those two. They only included Newton's four stanzas. They did not include the fifth stanza. When the ELW came out in the early 2000s, they put that fifth stanza back in. And it's one of my favorites. I love it. And this arrangement that I'm about to play for you, you can hear this triumphant ending of when we've been there 10,000 years. So it's just to think of 10,000 years with the kind of with the cloud of witnesses and what we talked a little bit about last week with holy, 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 and all the elders in heaven with the four beasts that were singing 10,000 years and bright shining as the sun. And then ending with, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun. So just this sense of eternity. And when we get to heaven and it's been 10,000 years that we've been in heaven, and at that point, we still have no less than 10,000 more years to sing. And so I'm really glad they put it in. So this is, and I am going to mute everybody for a second. Let me see if I can. Participants. Okay, so while I'm playing the video, I'm gonna mute everybody. So we'll see if I can unmute you when you're done. But this is me playing it as if I'm accompanying a hymn at the organ here. Thank you. So that is, oops, how do I, hang on, how do I unmute you? Cancel. That's just muting. More.
Maybe we can unmute ourselves.
Yeah, I just changed it so you can unmute yourself.
Okay.
I don't know how to just unmute everybody, but so why is that still? Okay, there we go. So that is one of my favorite ways to play Amazing Grace. You hear a little bit of melody soloed out there, and then at the end of the stanza, or the at the end of the fourth stanza, an interlude and modulation, we raised it up a half step to build that tension, actually a whole step we raised it up to build tension, and get that nice triumphant when we've been there 10,000 years, and you get that really low pedal point that you heard just rolling around underneath everything. So Amazing Grace was written in England. The text was written in England. The melody was written in America, and in a style that's called shape note singing. Shape note singing actually originated in 18th century England, but became very popular in America. When I was doing this, I had no idea that it originated in England. I've always known it as American. And it's really popular in North Carolina, Kentucky, Tennessee, like that kind of area of the country. And you can see that on the picture here, the note heads actually have different shapes. And over here on the scale, there's the triangle, that's a regular note, a square, another triangle, there's a diamond. And so it's a different way of reading music, and people who do shape note singing swear by it. And it you don't have to learn key signatures if you do shape notes, because the note is supposed to trigger a pitch in your head. And it's not very widely used anymore. There are still shape note societies that meet, and we're going to watch a video of one of them. There's shape note hymnals, and they get together. Usually the melody in a shape note song is in the tenor part. Sopranos rarely get the melody in shape note singing for some reason. So you can see Amazing Grace written there as shape notes. And if you know how to read music, you just ignore the fact that all the notes are different shapes and play it. But this, hang on, I need to change my share to, whoops, first I have to pull up a window, not that one. That one. Nope, stop. There we go. Did your picture just change to a YouTube video? Yep. Wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's not the one I want. This one is. Okay, so this explains, this is in the Smoky Mountains, and this explains what shape note singing is.
Cool.
Traditions of family and faith endure the generations in the Great Smoky Mountains, weaving the rich cultural history of this land.
Old harp singing, as we know it today in this area, began actually in the New England states, in the United States, and it is truly a uniquely American type of music in the way that the music is written and in the way that it is sung. This music is actually written down in the form of shapes instead of the round notes, so that people, if they're unable to read music that is written in a normal fashion, can look at the shapes and memorize the shapes and then memorize the tone that goes with that shape, and then they can sight read music and sing it in four-part harmony. And that was the idea that people had in writing this music in this way. To this area with the circuit riding preachers or traveling preachers or ministers that came through, and because of the isolation in the mountains here in East Tennessee, and in particular in Blountsville and Jefferson Knox County, this was a very popular style of music then, and it remained popular, and there were actually singing schools in this tradition in this area on a regular basis up through the 1950s.
The Primitive Baptist Church in Cades Cove was once used as a singing school. Though singing schools in the area are now held only occasionally, singers still gather for sings. Each singer has a chance to lead a song, and visitors are encouraged to sing along. First, the shapes are sung, each shaped note head representing a different syllable, do, re, mi, and so on. Then the lyrics, or poetry, as it is called. The tunes themselves date back to the old countries, England, Scotland, Ireland, and Germany, with some tunes dating back to the Middle Ages.
Some people have described this as being a dying tradition. If it ever took a dying breath, I was never aware of it. My ancestors have sung this type of music, I know, at least for five generations back. And there are many that sing with us that can make that same claim and even longer.
So that's a little bit about what shape note singing is. And you heard towards the first half of the video when they were singing, they weren't singing text, they were singing solfege, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. And that is common with shape note singing, that the first time you go through a song, you sing it as the introduction on solfege and not on text. So this is a shape note gathering, and these still happen regularly in certain areas. I think here in Virginia, there's one that every 2 months or so they get together. And this is how they sit in this square, and you saw that in the other video as well. Each person gets a turn. If you go to a shape note sing, if you want to, each person gets a turn to pick a song and to lead it. And so this guy standing here in the middle, it was his turn. And you see a lot of this movement with the arm. That's kind of how they conduct, and you can see some people in the choir singing that way as well. And so this is Amazing Grace sung in the shape note tradition. So that is Amazing Grace in the shape note style. It's very, in my opinion, very American. That sound, it was originated in England, that style of writing, but the Americans, I think, grabbed right onto it and made it our own. And you can kind of hear the hills of Tennessee and Kentucky and that, like, that style of worship, I think, comes right in. So, and there's many, let me scroll back here for a second. So down at the bottom here of the hymnal where you see Southern Harmony, that's a shape note hymnal, Southern Harmony. And so in the hymnal, in our hymnal, whenever you see anything that says Southern Harmony, you know it's a shape note song. And What Wondrous Love Is This? That's another popular shape note song. There's a Star in the East is a Christmas shape note song. The Hills Are Bare of Bethlehem. And so anything that has that kind of American openness of chords that you can recognize most likely is a shape note song. So a little bit of background on the text. A granite tombstone in a small cemetery in Olney, England reads, quote, John Newton, clerk, once an infidel and libertine, a servant of slavers in Africa, was by the rich mercy of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ preserved, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the faith he had long labored to destroy. That's actually what's on the writer of the hymn. That's what's on his tombstone. John Newton was acutely aware of the effect of God's amazing grace on his life. For many years, he was the captain of a slave ship, a trade that commonly involved cruel mistreatment of African men and women and resulted in many of their deaths. But on March 10th, 1748, Newton's ship experienced a frightening storm. At the time, Newton was reading the Christian classic Imitation of Christ by Thomas Kempis. The influence of the book and the terrifying storm led Newton to accept Christ as his savior. However, at that time, even though this was a very important time in his life and he didn't turn all the way. Newton continued his work in the slave trade for several more years after that. However, to make him feel better about himself, he improved conditions on his own ship. So he was still transporting slaves, but conditions weren't as bad. And he held services for the crew on the ship, but eventually became convicted of the inhumane work and became a crusader against slavery. So it took him a few years after this moment when he wrote Amazing Grace, and eventually saw the errors of his ways with slavery. Later in his life, he joined William Wilberforce to fight for the abolition of the slave trade in England, which became a reality in 1807, the year of his death. Leaving the life of sea captain, Newton settled down, married, and felt the call to enter the ministry. He was ordained into the Anglican Church at the age of 39 and served a church in Olney, England for the next 15 years. Newton often preached in his own church and in other services in the area about the grace he had experienced from God in spite of his checkered past. Large crowds would gather to hear, quote, the old converted sea captain. Instead of the customary Psalter hymns, Newton liked to incorporate simple, heartfelt songs into his services. Along with his friend William Cowper, he began to write hymns. In 1779, they produced the famous Olney Hymnal, which includes the well-known Amazing Grace. So it was 1779 that the poetry for Amazing Grace was first published. And as I said before, it didn't include the tune that we know it as with Amazing Grace, but it would just be chanted on a single line. And I think my iPad just froze again, so let me redo the share. We want that one. So the setup that I'm using today, we know next week is not a good one to use. For some reason, the connection keeps going away. Okay, so background text. The hymn Amazing Grace has a lot of obvious inspiration for the text. The first one in the middle there Luke 15, 4 through 32, which is the it starts with the parable of the lost sheep, and goes to the lost coin with the widow who has 10 coins and loses one, and then finally the prodigal son. I think that's the usually whenever we have the prodigal son gospel, we always sing Amazing Grace. But it's also based on Psalm 73. The 26th verse says, "My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." Romans 3:24 is more inspiration. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Ephesians 2:4-9, "But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast." Just a really quick aside, Marcia, I'm going to bring up your grandson. We were singing a hymn based on this text at the end, so that no one may boast. I remember, Sean was little. This was at least 10.
3 or 4.
Yeah, and singing in the choir, and we were singing on Reformation Sunday. He was with the kids' choir, and he was one of the only ones that showed up at the early service ready to warm up, and we're going through the text, and the text ended, "Don't let anybody boast." And I remember Sean singing as loud as he could, "Don't let anybody burst." It was funny. I had never heard that while we were practicing. So anyway, back to Amazing Grace. 1 Timothy 1:12-14 is more inspiration for the text. "I am grateful to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he judged me faithful and appointed me to his service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a man of violence. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus." And so that's, I think, parallels John Newton's life really well, talking about his former life and then when he turned and saw the light and everything. So what Amazing Grace, and the full title of the hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. That's so iconic in our culture, I think, Amazing Grace. And what exactly does grace mean? In the dictionary, it says, "The love and mercy given to us by God, because God desires us to have it, not necessarily because of anything we have done to earn it." So grace is, in our belief, is unconditional. It is always there. It always has been. There is nothing you can do to earn it. It has nothing to do with you at all. Grace can both teach us to fear and relieve our fears. And we'll talk about that a little bit later on, that it both with grace, we learn to fear, and we also learn to move beyond our fears. And so we'll talk about that later. Grace brings us through dangers and trials. And there's, whenever we talk a little bit about like the Lord's Prayer or something, and you get to the line, "Deliver us from evil." Or no, it's not that. "Our Father who art in heaven, lead me not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Yeah. Where it's not that you won't have dangers and trials in your life, but that God will be there with you, with God's grace, to bring you through the dangers and trials. And so I had read earlier a little bit of Ephesians 2, and Ephesians 2, 1 through 10, before we get to that, a little bit of the actual Bible study curriculum here talks about grace and grace alone. And they say, crash, you hear the sound of shattering glass. Following the noise, you rush to the front of the hall where your 5-year-old son stands next to what was an expensive flower vase, looking up at you with sheepish, penitent eyes. You take a deep breath and consider a couple of options. Go with your initial reaction and send him to his room for a year, or show him grace. Grace is essentially undeserved kindness. Most of us have experienced grace with our fellow human beings. Maybe we have made a serious mistake at work or forgotten the all-important wedding anniversary, but the boss did not fire us or the spouse did not make us sleep on the couch. That is grace. That is mercy. That is not getting what we deserved. God extends God's grace to all of us. Not one of us can earn God's way. Not one of us can earn their way into heaven by being good enough, doing enough deeds of charity, or giving away enough money. We are all imperfect human beings born with a sinful nature, but we can receive grace from God because of Jesus' sacrifice for us. Think back to the incident of the broken flower vase that I brought up here. If the vase is to be replaced, someone has to pay for it. Imagine the vase cost $100 and your five-year-old son has no means to earn that much money. If you decide to pay for it, you are demonstrating grace. If our relationship with God is to be restored, someone has to pay that price for the wrongs we have done, the mistakes we have made, and the hurts we have caused. Since we could never do enough to pay that price, Jesus paid it for us. The Message Bible puts it this way, quote, this is their translation of Romans 3:24. Out of sheer generosity, God put us in right standing with God's self, a pure gift. He got us out of the mess we're in and restored us to where God always wanted us to be. And God did it by the means of Jesus Christ. And so Ephesians 2 here, where they talk about grace, you were dead through the trespasses of sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. And all of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of the flesh and senses. And we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. And then it goes on to the passage that I read earlier about God, who is rich in mercy, has saved you through Jesus Christ. And he ends in verse 10 here. For we are what has made us, created in Jesus Christ for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. And so that references a little bit of the fifth stanza of Amazing Grace with the 10,000 years, and that God exists outside of time. We have nothing to do with grace. It's always there. God has done it already. And 10,000 years ago, before God prepared our life, that was there, and it always has been. In the beginning here, I want to note where the first verses 1-3, where he talks about being dead, Paul describes our natural state as being dead in verses 1-3 there, and how that plays into salvation. Hang on a second. I thought there was a waiting room thing, but I just realized I don't have my waiting room up. Let me find it in case somebody does come in. Participates. There we go. Wonderful. Okay. Being dead, playing into our salvation, goes back with this hymn about how it has nothing to do with us, that we're born sinful, we're born dead to sin. And it's almost like a finality to our life right from the beginning, that there's nothing we can do to earn God's grace. You were born dead. Like that's the end of it. And through the grace of God are given the gift of salvation. And they have you think of a time. Oh, you guys can't see my screen. Why is this keep doing this? Hang on. I'm going to change the way I'm doing this. And where is my PowerPoint? There it is. New share, PowerPoint, share. Okay, so you should see my actual PowerPoint program right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me go to this. Okay, that should work. Okay, I'll stop using my iPad. We'll just use that. Let me get to the right screen now. There it is. So this is what I was talking about, Paul describing our natural state in verses 1-3 there. And thinking about a time when you received grace that you didn't deserve. And kind of like in that story of the child who broke the vase, and with how much it cost, and there's no way the child can repay that. And that's the same way that God took care of us with our sins, and that there's no way we can repay that. And Jesus did that for us, just like the parent did it for their child. Then there's a quote from Martin Luther that just came to mind that I should have looked up beforehand, but talking about one of his children was sitting in the corner of the kitchen crying and screaming and pitching a fit or whatever. And Martin Luther says something to the effect of that there is no reason why I should love that being in the corner that's acting so ridiculous right now, but for some reason I do. And so that's kind of with God, that it does, we can be as ridiculous as we're going to be, and that doesn't change. And grace, okay, so earlier I talked about how, hang on, I'm using the wrong device now. There we go. Grace both alleviates our fears and inspires fear. And how can that be possible? And I had to think about this for quite a while and do some research of how can the amazing grace both relieve us of our fear, but also inspire us to fear. And there are two types of fears. These are Greek words, deila and phobos. They are both translations of the word fear. And in this passage here, let me find it on here. There it is. So this is in the Bible study. They talk about the story of Jesus calming the storm in Mark chapter 4, verses 35-41. And one evening, Jesus suggested to his disciples that they cross over to the other side of the lake. While they were out, the water was raging and there was a huge storm, and Jesus was asleep during all of this. And they talk about the disciples out of fear waking Jesus, and Jesus wakes and says, "Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" So in that portion, the Greek word for fear is deila, which indicates a cowardice and a timidity. There we go. Thank you. And is never used in a positive way. And so that's kind of what we think of with fear, the terror and being scared. But later on, that story of Jesus calming the storm goes on. Mark tells us next that the disciples became very much afraid and said to one another, "Who is it that even the wind and the sea obey him?" So Jesus has calmed the storm, and now the disciples are looking at each other in fear. And this word is phobos, for the word fear. Whoops, I just lost my screen. There it is. Like deila, it can mean being scared or terrified, but can also mean signify a reverential fear and a sense of awe. And so that's how the amazing grace, with John Newton's story, the author of the text here, when he was on a ship and was scared that he was going to die during the storm, it's the same thing as in that story with the disciples. That fear, the amazing grace, brought him through that and turned his life around to eventually stop being a slave trader. And then also the phobos, the being a sense of awe. At God's power, that once you can see that grace and what it can do for you. And in my mind, as I was researching this, constantly went back to last week's hymn with Holy, 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 and the sense of awe, and the glass and the glassy sea and everything, and God's power. And so that's how grace can be both alleviate fears and inspire our fears. In Psalm 118, the text for here, this is talking about fear again. "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. Out of my distress, I call on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. With the Lord on my side, I do not fear. What can mortals do to me? The Lord is on my side to help me. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in mortals. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations surround me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surround me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surround me like bees. They blazed like a fire of thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. And so this, you can see the two types of fear here. In verse 4 of the psalm, let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. And that's that first kind of fear the Dila fear there that you can see in verse 4 that indicates terror. And then in verse 6, we get the other kind of fear. With the Lord on my side, I do not fear. What can mortals do to me? And so with the Lord on my side, I can see the sense of awe. And it's, I think, is a great psalm for right now with our anxiety. I invite you, this is Psalm 118, verses 1 through 14. It's not, I don't think it's in our lectionary. It's not one that I was really familiar with, but I like the repetition in it. And I think it's a good psalm for our times right now, with our anxiety in society and with the pandemic and everything that's going on. And I invite you to write that down, Psalm 118, and read it throughout the week and use it as a bit of a meditation for yourself, because we all are constantly feeling anxious with everything that's going on. But I think identifying the two types of fear in our anxiety is something that can be really helpful with this hymn. I lost my mouse. There it is. So God's grace gives us strength in times of trial. We have already learned that the grace is undeserved kindness. There's nothing we've done to deserve. There's nothing we can do. God's grace is extended to us and received by faith, enables us to escape the eternal punishment and instead enjoy a friendship with God, both now and forever. We are changed by grace. It causes us to love our Lord and seek to please God. Grace begins the original transformation, but also maintains it. It is as if grace is not only the original spark that started the fire of love and trust that God has in our hearts, but it is also the fuel that keeps it going. Grace is an abundant supply. It offers all that we need to complete our work here on earth. Paul writes, and God is able to make all grace abound in you so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. And in Ephesians later on, Paul goes on to write, but to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ appointed. He goes on to explain how grace appears in the form of many gifts that we all have to build each other up. And so there's a reference here and in the hymn as well to extend this grace to everyone and to build each other up with it. In the hymn Amazing Grace, Newton mentions his many dangers, toils, and snares. Life is full of temptations, problems, and trials, and it's God's grace that gives us the strength to get through them. First, grace in the form of assurance of God's love and kindness First, grace in the form of assurance of God's love and kindness to us gives us a joy beyond our problems in our lives. Second, grace as God's power working in us supplies us with limitless strength and hope, enabling us to endure whatever comes our way. Trials, in fact, are the best way to increase our supply of God's grace in our lives. And so these times with the pandemic, I think really focusing on that, and that it was a trial in John Newton's life that first exposed him to see God's grace. And how can we use these times to see God's grace in our lives? And 2 Corinthians 12 with this says, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations, therefore, to keep me from being too elated A thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for the power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weakness, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. And so this part, I think, goes on to talk too about with right now, along with that psalm that we read, our trials. You've all heard the cliche of building character as you go through hard times, and also seeing it as seeing God's grace. And then in Ephesians, there's a verse here that they put in, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in order that in the coming ages, he might show the incomparable riches of his grace. And John Newton experienced God's astounding grace in his life. That initial spark of grace amazed him and changed his life. Then the kindness of God he received through that faith erased his sinful past and set him on a new course. Through no effort of his own could accomplish salvation, Newton was on the road to heaven. Newton had experienced terror at sea, just as the disciples had. And like the disciples, the power of God changed the fear of perishing at sea into a reward and awe of his Lord. And so talking about the fear, grace both instilling fear and instilling awe, a different kind of fear. We all have problems and hard times on earth. Newton was no exception. He even experienced blindness at the end of his life, yet he was confident that the fuel of God's grace and power would get him through all trials and would eventually lead him home toward heaven. Toward the close of his life, Newton marveled at God's grace, declaring, quote, my memory is nearly gone, but I remember two things, that I'm a great sinner and that Christ is a great savior. And so that was, it's interesting to see Newton's life kind of come full circle. And after he first experienced that storm on the ship that caused him to turn to God and to see God's grace, but still remain a slave trader just with better conditions on his ships, to eventually being an activist against the slave trade and leading to its abolishment in England, to going into the ministry and becoming a minister. And they have, if I can get here, some action points. And this is just some stuff for you to kind of think about throughout the week. Whoops, what did I just do? Hang on, go back. There it is. First they have, think of a time you experienced terror and the Lord helped you overcome it, or think of a time you were filled with the awe of God, his power and overwhelming love. And so that's something I think you can add if you're looking at Psalm 118, to kind of think about as you go through that. The second one, think of an area in your life where you feel weak or even helpless. Write this area on a piece of paper and then cover it with the words, my grace is sufficient for you. Thank God for this opportunity to see God's power at work in your life. Ask God for a special measure of grace for this problem and watch for God's answers. And that's an important part of it too, is to watch for God's answers, be still in your life so you can see how God is answering that. And then lastly, next time you sing Amazing Grace, sing it with a new appreciation of God's mercy and power in your life. It really is a wonderful text. And I want to go back here to, I think the easiest way will be to escape out of here. If I can, there we go. My computer's running slow because of all the tabs I have open. Okay, so the text. Lastly, I just want to read through the text again and talk about it a little bit. And the first stanza, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. And I think it's interesting that in that first stanza, you have the statement, Amazing Grace, but before they go on, it's almost like you're stopping to talk about how truly amazing that grace is, how sweet the sound. And the way the punctuation and the grammar is there is correct. That's how it's printed in the hymnal. You have the exclamation point in the middle of a sentence, and how is lowercase. And so it's just to emphasize the amazingness of that. That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believe. And in that stanza, there's so much more in that than I saw before, with the teaching my heart to fear, and also grace is what relieved my fears. That's a lot deeper than I originally saw it. And also, how precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed, going to how grace has always been there, and it's nothing we can do. And so once we our eyes are open to see it, it's there, it's always surrounding you. And then stanza three, through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. And so more talking about how grace is always there for us. The Lord has promised good to me, his word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. And then finally, it's stanza five, the anonymous stanza that John Newton did not write. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we'd first begun. And so, as I mentioned before, I really just like that 10,000 years, and that this is 10,000 years from now, once we've been in heaven for 10,000 years, and that we still, for all of eternity, have at least 10,000 more to go, because it's never ending. I hope you have a new appreciation, I think, for the hymn. There's definitely a lot in there. And I was wondering if anybody had any insights that they thought of as they were looking at the text, or anything about grace in general that they were interested in sharing.
What was the question again?
If there is anything that stands out to you with the text of Amazing Grace, anything that you might find important that comforts you in your life, or something new that you learned that you want to keep fresh in your mind.
I know when I sing it, I usually tear up while singing it, and I have no idea why, Jeremy.
Yeah, it's one of those that can definitely do that to you. It's very common at funerals, and so that
it's touching for some reason, very touching.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Has anybody seen there's a movie, Amazing Grace? And it's not, I think I checked, it's not on Netflix. But it came out maybe 15 years ago. Let me Google it real quick. Let's see here. Amazing.
Was it based on a children's book?
I'm not sure. It's the story of John Newton's life.
Okay.
Hang on, I just pulled up the trailer. I'll share my screen here on the trailer for a second, and we can watch that. Let me pause this. Go to Zoom. So it was in 2006 that this came out. Okay, hang on, share screen. Amazing Grace, share. Okay, this is the trailer for the movie.
Amazing Grace, how sweet.
What do you want with your old preacher?
I'm here to seek your advice.
Like me.
Are you contemplating a life of solitude? People like you too much. Besides,
Wilbur, you have work to do.
Blind, but now I see.
No one of our age has ever taken power, which is why we're too young to realize that certain things are impossible.
You're the best fighter in the house and the best speaker.
Where does this little terrier spring from?
I believe he's a Yorkshire terrier, my lord.
One man will risk everything.
Payment in kind.
There's nothing you have I'd want, Your Grace.
He'd fetch at least 25 guineas.
The game is over.
To speak for those who could not.
Say to this, to let you know that you no longer belong to God, but to a man.
To make the blind see.
We have no evidence that the Africans themselves have any objection to the trade.
And to lead a movement that would change the world.
Do it. Build their dirty, filthy ships out of the water.
The slave trade has 300 MPs in its pocket. It would be just you against them.
If we were to outlaw the trade tomorrow, this would bring financial disaster.
His enemy is my enemy.
Wilberforce is a rebel.
No matter how loud you shout, you will not drown out the voice of the people!
People!
You still have passion. That matters more.
In Africa, I was a prince, in many ways not unlike you.
I'm going to try again.
As your prime minister, I urge caution.
And as my friend?
Not to hell with caution.
Remember, God made men equal.
Was blind, but now I see.
Did I write that?
Yes, you did.
Now at last it's true.
Amazing Grace.
It's got an impressive cast. Yeah. Has anybody seen that movie?
I feel like I might have, but I want to see it again.
I
haven't seen it, but I want to watch it. That young man is the same young man I'm watching now in Horatio Hornblower.
Oh, nice. Uh-huh.
Benedict, what is it? Something Benedict, I think.
Benedict Cumberbatch.
Cumberbatch.
And let me see. Usually they have a where to watch it. All watch options.
It's Amazon.
So it looks like you can rent it from Amazon. It doesn't look like it's available free anywhere. But it's
something I'd like to watch.
Yeah, it's called Amazing Grace. It came out in 2006. And I've seen bits and pieces of it, but I don't think I've seen the entire thing. So by all means, check that out. That's the during quarantine. That's a good movie to watch, I think. So I think that's what I have this evening. But thank you everybody for joining us. It's always great to see faces. tomorrow's Wednesday, and we have the More Days for Praise service again, 7 o'clock in the parking lot. We'll set up the same way we did last week, where the handicap space is basically everybody's welcome to put their chairs there. Make sure you stay at least 6 feet apart. Have a mask on until you're seated, almost just like when you're at a restaurant as you're walking through before your table. There you go, Bob. Yes. have your mask on. And then once you're seated, you can take it off. There's no singing at the service. It's all spoken word. And with being outside and with just speaking and with staying 6 feet apart, we're being as safe as we can be with that. And tomorrow's service is based on the commemoration for Peter Claver. And he was a missionary from England, I believe, to Colombia, and really focused on the ministering to the indigenous people of Colombia and some of the slaves that they had there. And when he would go on his trips to minister, he would insist on living in the slave quarters with people and build a trust between the indigenous people and himself. And there's a lot of interesting stuff about his life. So that's what tomorrow's service will be based on at 7 o'clock.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you guys. And then this weekend, is regular worship at 10 o'clock. So, any questions or any other comments?
I noticed that people were typing as they were leaving. So, how does that work?
Do you see the chat window? If you, at the bottom of your screen of the Zoom window, in the middle, there should be a button that says chat.
Yeah.
If you click on that, it should open up a window. And at the bottom of that, it says type message here.
Oh, okay. So
if you type in there, and you can either send it to everyone, or if you want to send a message just to one specific person, you click the arrow next to everyone and then pick the person
cool.
you
want to do. I'm learning, folks. So
it's the 21st century of passing notes in class.
Yeah.
So very good. Well, it's great to see everyone. I'm going to work on the ensemble gatherings. We'll have a gathering for the choir members and a gathering for the bell choir, and we'll just do some straight up fellowship, and I'll play some YouTube videos of fun things. We'll work on that. And if anybody has any other great ideas on ways that we can socialize and do activities at church that are still safe with the pandemic, we are all ears. And so.
Well, thank you. That was very good.
Good.
Thank you so much, Jeremy.
Good night, and thank you.
Have a good night, everybody. Jeremy.